Duckworth was talking about. You know, where he started to describe it, he didn't say that, he didn't use the words having an alcoholic mind, but he was describing the same situation, okay? And so back here on page 27, it says, a friend felt as though the gates of hell had closed on him with a clang. You know, and think of that for a second. You know, I'm sure one or two of you have been in jail. You know, you're probably not very good alcoholics if you haven't. That's not true. But, I mean, I know I've been in jail, okay, as a result of drinking. And when I went in there and they closed this door and I threw that lock across, you know, it makes a big clunk, clunk, you know, a big noise. And that's what I envision going on here when he says the gates of hell closed on him with a clang. I hear that noise of that mechanism going over. So Roland, it goes on here, he says, he said to the doctor, is there no exception? Yes, replied the doctor, there is. Exceptions to cases such as yours have been occurring since early times. Okay. Here and there, once in a while. All right, this is what Dr. Young is telling them. Here and there, you know, once in a while, what happens? Something happens. It's not very frequent, not very often. Okay, here and there, once in a while, alcoholics have what are called vital spiritual experiences. To me, these occurrences are phenomena. Okay, so Dr. Young is saying these vital spiritual experiences that these alcoholics are a phenomenon to him. What the word phenomenon means is it's unexplainable. It happens, but he can't tell you why it happens. He can't tell you how it happens, but he knows that it happens. Okay? And he goes on to describe what these vital spiritual experiences are. He says, they appear to be in the nature of huge emotional displacements and rearrangements. Okay, ideas, emotions, and attitudes, which were once the guiding forces of the lives of these men, are suddenly cast to one side, and a completely new set of conceptions and motives begin to dominate them. Okay, so the ideas that we have, he's saying, the guys that have recovered, you know, he doesn't know how it happens, but here's what happens to them. They get rid of all their old ideas. They get rid of all their old emotions. They get rid of that old thought process that they had, and they replace it with something new. Now, if we go back and look at the doctor's opinion, Dr. Silkworth tells us the same thing. Turn your book over. I've got a fourth edition. So in the fourth edition, the Roman numerals pages in the beginning of the book are different from a third edition. So if you get a third edition, you're going to have to look a few pages left or right of where I'm going to tell you to go. But in the fourth edition, we want to look at Roman numeral 29. That's XXIX. Okay? And here, Dr. Silkworth, he starts off on the bottom of Roman numeral 28. And does everybody catch up with me? Is everybody in the right spot? You know, we good to go? If you look down the bottom of the page, Roman numeral 28, Dr. Silkworth says, men and women drink essentially because they like the effect produced by alcohol. The sensation is so elusive that, while they admit it is injurious, they cannot, after a time, differentiate the true from the false. To them, their alcoholic life seems the only normal one. They are restless, irritable, and discontent unless they can again experience a sense of ease and comfort, which comes at once by taking a few drinks. Drinks they see others taking with impunity. After they have succumbed to the desire again, as so many do, and the phenomena of craving develops. Now see here, Dr. Silkworth is talking about a phenomena of craving, all right? He knows that this craving thing exists, but again, he can't explain it. Why? You know, Jung can't explain this spiritual thing, right? So Silkworth says, and the phenomena of craving develops, they pass through the well-known stages of a spree, emerging remorseful, with the firm resolution not to drink again. He says, this is repeated over and over, and unless this person can experience an entire psychic change, there is very little hope of his recovery. All right, this is Dr. Silkworth saying this. I'm going to read this one more time. We'll go back to page 27 and look and compare these things for a second. This is repeated over and over, and unless this person can experience an entire psychic change, there is very little hope of his recovery. Let's go, keep your finger there because we're going to go back to that page in a minute. But let's go back over to page 27. And it says, you have the mind of a chronic alcoholic. This is repeated over and over again. I have never seen one single case recover where that state of mind existed to the extent that it does in you. Young saying that. Silkworth is saying, unless this person can experience an entire psychic change, there is very little hope of his recovery. Okay, two different doctors telling us the same thing, that something's going on here, and we don't understand it, and we can't help you. You know, we don't know how to help you. So if you go on reading Silkworth, he says, on the other hand, and strange as this may seem to those who do not understand, once a psychic change has occurred, the very same person who seemed doomed, who had so many problems he despaired of ever solving them, suddenly finds himself easily able to control his desire for alcohol. The only effort necessary being that required to follow a few simple rules. Okay, if we go back to page 27 again, what does it say over here? On the top of page 27, the last part of that sentence is, provided he remained willing to maintain a certain simple attitude, following the rules that Silkworth was talking about. They go about having this vital spiritual experience that Jung calls it. Silkworth calls it a vital psychic change. They're talking about the same thing, using different words, okay? Both doctors are telling us the same thing has to happen. You know, going back to on page 27 now, to Jung talking to Roland Hazard, he says, they appear to be in the nature of huge emotional displacements and rearrangements. Ideas, emotions, and attitudes which were once the guiding forces of the lives of these men are suddenly cast to one side, and a completely new set of conceptions and motives begin to dominate them. In fact, I've been trying to produce some such emotional rearrangement within you. With many individuals, the methods which I employed are successful, but I have never been successful with an alcoholic of your description. All right? Here, Dr. Jung is saying to him, you know, I've used this stuff and gotten some success with other people, but somebody with the mind of a chronic alcoholic, I have never been successful. Here's what has to happen. I can't make it happen. That's what the doctor's telling us. The other doctor's saying the same thing. We have to have this psychic change. They don't know how to bring it about, you know. So where does that leave us, you know? It goes on here on the bottom of page 27. It says, upon hearing this, our friend was somewhat relieved, for he reflected that, after all, he was a good church member. This hope, however, was destroyed by the doctors telling him that while his religious convictions were very good, in his case, they did not spell the necessary vital spiritual experience. You guys understand the meaning of the words necessary? Vital. Okay? Necessary has to happen. All right. Vital. It's important. All right. We have to have this spiritual experience. All right. Jung recognized this, but he didn't know how to make it happen. All right. And that's a problem that we face. Turn the page to page 28. And that's what it says right here at the top of page 28. It says, here was the terrible dilemma in which our friend found himself when he had the extraordinary experience, which, as we have already told you, made him a free man. You know, a terrible dilemma. You know, think about that. If you're new coming in here, think about where you're at right now, what's going through your head. Me, I came around here for 8 years, relapsing the whole time, back and forth, and you know, and that's the dilemma I'm in. You folks are telling me that I got to stop drinking. And I'm telling you, I can't stop drinking. And they say, yeah, but you gotta.